Okay, is this working? I think we can start. first of all, good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming to see this talk. I'm Dario Fagioli. I work from Citrix. Allow me, as a first thing, to apologize for this voice and for, in general, not feeling exactly as awesome as possible. But I hope you still would be able to understand something. And yeah, let's go on. As I said, my name is Dario. I work for our Citrix. I have the pleasure to work, to be a full-time open source developer for the XAMM project, so the XAMM hypervisor. And that's what I'm going to talk about this morning. So. I will try to illustrate why the XAMM hypervisor could be a good solution for enabling virtualization with open source software, which the XAMM project is, in many different kind of embedded systems. And to do so, I will give you an overview of the XAMM architecture, an overview of the embedded virtualization scenario, and my view of why XAMM could be a good fit for it. And well, we will discuss about the numbers that I have. So let's get started for real. What is XAMM and what is architecture at least at a glance? So XAMM is what we call the microkernel-based type 1, so bare metal hypervisor. And I'm saying microkernel because it really is a very thin layer of software running, sitting exactly on top of hardware with nothing underneath it, and in charge of just the CPUs, the memory, and let's say the interrupts. There is nothing in there which deals with anything like device drivers and any of such things. And that's why we call it a microkernel. Everything that runs on top of XAMM, we call it a domain. And so as you see in this picture, there are a multiplicity of domains. One which we usually like to highlight in a little bit of a special manner because it's DOM 0, which is what we call the control domain. And in fact, as I said, XAMM doesn't want to deal with device drivers, with devices and their drivers, but someone else too. And in the XAMM architecture, that is DOM 0. So basically, we provide some special capabilities to DOM 0 to allow to be hit the trans the driver for I don't know, the network card, the disks, and all the things that you want to have in your platform. And also the access to them is still mediated to XAMM, still goes through XAMM. As I said, the actual drivers resides there. The other one, the other domains are the actual, what we usually call the guests, so the actual virtual machines. And this connection between this brick here called PV backend and this other one called PV frontends is how, access to the devices is shared with the further deviation of the mediation of DOM 0 to all the various other domains. So this is a very quick and high-level overview. Allow me for just give you a very a slightly more detailed view of the architecture, because there is something which I will at least cite later in the presentation, which is one of the one of the advanced capabilities of Xen to deal with what we call driver domains. So it's more or less similar to what we saw before, but in this case, it is no longer DOM0, as you see, but run the actual drivers for the devices in the hardware. But it's these, in this case, these two other domains. We call this one the disk driver domain, this one the network driver domain. So in this one, one on the right is where the driver for the network card resides, and it is with this brick now that the guests talk in order to get access to the network. And the same is true for disk, also with this other domain. This is all a lot flexible. This is just one representation, but you can shuffle the thing pretty much in any possible way. And this is very powerful, very provides you a lot of flexibility when designing your platform on top of Xen, provide if you use it correct way, provide a high degree of security and resilience. It's very cool and we like it, okay? So, what is Xen about these days? Xen is an hypervisor born at the computer lab of the Cambridge University. It then was commercialized by a spin-off company, and through various steps and a long process, it became an open source project, and now it is a Linux Foundation collaborative project, meaning that our home is now the actual Linux Foundation, the same that that provides similar services to the Linux kernel and to a bunch of other projects, to be fair. The major use case when Xen was born, but this is something which is still true, is either enterprise or server virtualization or cloud computing. For example, Xen is what runs the all the major cloud providers out there, like Verizon, like Rackspace, like of course Amazon EC2. They're all built on top of Xen. And yet, later you may have heard about Xen and also other open source hypervisors, to be fair, being ported to ARM, which is true, which is a big thing, and which started because ARM decided to enter the server market, starting to provide specification for high-end processors with virtualization extensions. So a few more words about this ARM port that we recently did and that we are still perfecting. It started from scratch, meaning that it doesn't borrow anything from the old x86 ports, which means that you get to write it with a lot of backward experience, which allow you to make a lot less mistakes. It exploits the hardware virtualization extension available in the latest ARM chips. You only need to have one type of guest, no emulation, so no device model like QEMU is required. And as I said, it supports the V7 and V8 ARM specification. It runs already on a bunch of boards. So I want you to notice that the first two, XGene and Midway, are server-grade hardware, which the Xen community managed to get its hands on with pre-arrangement in order to be ready when they will really ship to the market. The other one are especially these three mostly either developer board or toy board, which are very handy for doing development. And this last one is actually an automotive friendly board from TI, and in general the OMAP 5 is an embedded or automotive, let's call it like that, SOC. So means to say that the other port started for the sake of servers, but allowed us to start to look at a bunch of different scenarios, which indeed is embedded virtualization. So let's talk a little bit about embedded systems and then of embedded virtualization. To cut it very short, embedded systems are a piece of hardware which have a very dedicated and specific purpose. If we look at a little bit at the history of embedded system, we see that they started as a very low power microcontrollers being able only to be programmed with custom firmwares. Then we grew more powerful and were able to run full-fledged operating system. And now we are at the phase of the evolution chain where they even can run hypervisors. And software support followed. So firmware, which was truly special purpose, designed for truly special purposes, then the OS provided you some more flexibility, and the hypervisor provided you even more flexibility and more isolation, so you're now allowed to run a bunch of different, to be a very advanced platform on top of them. So a couple of scenarios, the mobile, tablet, phones, whatever, which basically means running an hypervisor on your phone or tablet, which accounts for the use case known as bring your own device, meaning that you have either your company gives you a phone or you have your own phone which you want to use both for your personal use and at work, and that you want these two uses to be to happen on the same hardware, but to be independent enough to not compromise each other. You know? And so the idea is to do that by having an hypervisor and having two actual virtual machines with a mobile operating system like Android installed on both of them, but with different data and accounts and whatever. So be sure that you watch that one is the URL of a presentation which has a link to a video. Which was given by the presentation was given by Samsung at the latest Xen Developer Summit in Edinburgh, which is actually showing this thing on a Samsung tablet. There has been a talk about this exact thing yesterday morning. There has been a demo about this yesterday at the Xen booth. There will be a demo today as well. Can you help me with the time, because I don't have the schedule with me? When you are going to be at our booth?
It's
half past 1 to 3. So if you want to see two Android on the same tablet, be sure you can buy at the same booth in the exhibition area from 1:30 to 3. And the other use case, automotive. So you are in a car, you have to account for a bunch of things that wants to be going on a car, which basically is the whole lot of stuff that are needed to control the car and the various mechanical and electronical components. But also you want you, or better, your kids behind you to watch a movie and play a game with Android in a touch screen embedded in the back of the driver's seat or something like that, the famous infotainment. And again, another presentation given at the Xen Summit where someone from Global Logic, which we are very happy about because they are starting to be active in our community, sending patches, contributing their work to the Xen Open Source project, talks and demos, one of the projects which is right doing this thing here. So very often embedded is coupled with real time. I don't want to bother you with technical and academic real-time definitions. Basically, what comes to mind when talking about real times is low latency, so quick response, and determinism, so predictability. So in the classic real-time scenario, so let's put aside virtualization for a minute. What happens is that some events, some stimulus come, such as an interrupt, and some action has to occur as a response, which for example, maybe waking up, let's wake up a task from a waking state. And doing that goes through a number of phases in the hardware and in the operating system. Each one of them comes with a price in terms of time, so latency, and the whole operation, the time it takes, we usually call the latency for the task to wake up, and whether this operation takes always the same amount of time or this amount of time varies, then we have more or less predictability and determinism, and we call the amount by which it varies usually jitter. So this is a classical interrupt delivery and latency measurement in an operating system. And for example, the one that the operating system, the implementation of the operating system is responsible for is usually the scheduling latency and the scheduler duration, which means that it depends from the implementation and the configuration of your operating system how frequently the scheduler will run and have a chance to pick up a task which just became ready, and how long, how complex this operation is, and thus how long does it take. And that, of course, impacts on the overall duration and overall latency. So what happens, the picture is the same, forgive me about that, but when you stick an hypervisor at the bottom of the down to the operating system, what happens is that all these components, apart from probably the very first one, but all these components grow another factor in the equation, additive mostly, most likely, which is because now the interrupt have to go through the hypervisor and then through the operating to and through the operating system. You now most likely have two schedulers, one responsible for scheduling the vCPUs of the virtual machine and then one inside the virtual machine. And so these both potentially affect the latency because it's going to last, every phase is going to last probably a little longer, and also the determinism predictability because it's another source of either being constant time, which would be great, or varying amount of time, which would add to the jitter component of the formula. So, what do we? Let's jump on discussing a bit the Xen specifics of. The general concept that we have introduced up to now. So basically, we are just finished talking a little bit about scheduling and the scheduler implementation, all the scheduler implementations. And scheduler, Xen does have, of course, a vCPU scheduler. As a matter of fact, it has more than one. Or as a matter of fact, it has a very nice and easy to extend framework, which is very comfortable for one to look at and learn how to write your own implementation of your preferred scheduling algorithm. In the mainstream, in the upstream Xen repository, mainstream Xen distribution comes with four schedulers, which are this one in bold. Credit is the default one, so it's the most stable, the one that gets the most of testing and everyday usage. And of course, since the Xen use case is still mostly about enterprise virtualization cloud and big iron stuff, these are the workloads where Credit is being exercised every day and is known to work quite well. Of course, there is no. It doesn't mean that it cannot work in other situations. Just it's something that it's not happening today. Credit 2 is a re-implementation of Credit with more of the interactive workloads in mind, meaning that if you are running audio, video decoding, your VMs, Credit 2 should perform better than Credit, or at least it's designed to do so. but it's still considered in the experimental stage. It's not ready for production yet. Then we have SCDF, which is a proper and true real-time scheduler, which Xen comes with. But I wouldn't really recommend to use it. Actually, stay away from it or get in touch with me and we can discuss about it, craft together patches and fix it, because right now it used to be the default scheduler. Then when credit took over, it got betrothed a bit. So it's good to have there to have it there, because at least I plan to fix it at some time. But right now, if you want to use it, be sure to get in touch with the development community so that we can make sure that the result you get doesn't upset you, because it's a little bit broken, so it's supposed to deliver strange results. And then there's the last one, which has been implemented and is maintained by Dornerworks, because they wanted an hypervisor, a virtualization solution ready for their workload, which is defense and avionics systems. And ARINC 653 is real-time, it's also real-time, but it says the downside of being a very static scheduler, so it's probably not going to work well in dynamic scenarios like the one we were visiting before. But still, it serves its purpose, because it allows these people to use Xen in these highly critical scenarios. So the credit scheduler, as I was saying, is the default one. Gives it its best in the classic Xen scenarios of enterprise and cloud virtualization, but still it has some parameters which allows for it to be tweaked in order to, for example, behave a little bit better in the scenarios where you need faster responses. For example, with this line here, you can change the time slice, which is pretty high, because the default is trying to maximize throughput. But if you need, if you can afford a little less throughput and you want to push farther on fast responses and low latencies, this is something you can change. Of course, you can change the priority of the various vCPUs or the various VM, which are weights and which are relative, which are considered in a global way, and the vCPUs are scheduled according to the ratios of the respective weights. Anyway, there are in this web page there of our wiki, there is a pretty complete description of the characteristic and all the possible tweaks of the week of the credit scheduler. If you want to do real-time stuff, of course, we will have SCDF back working at some point, but for now there is this nice project, which is also collaborating with us, with the upstream community, and which we are figuring out how to further even more this collaboration and have some of the stuff that they've done merged in the upstream Xen, which is basically, as I was saying, we have this very pleasant scheduling framework to work with, and basically these guys from this research project at those two universities, Washington and Pennsylvania, have produced a couple more of real-time schedulers, each with at least two operational mode, which should allow you to do pretty much advanced real-time system stuff. It's about resource reservation. I can give you some more details if you want later or offline. Just wanted to show the big picture here. So other things that can be tweaked in order to achieve better performances in the scenarios that we are interested about here is, for example, the vCPU pinning, which is another thing that Xen supports. So you can, yeah, I'm sorry for the formatting here. Something went wrong with the template, my fault. But anyway, which this means is that you can decide that a certain set of virtual CPUs, instead of just running on all on any of the PCPUs on the hardware platform, may be confined to a certain subset of them. So you can assign virtual CPU to physical CPU, either exclusively or a bunch of virtual to a bunch of physical, and all this kind of stuff, all the flexibility. In this example here we have, this means that vCPU 0 of this virtual machine can run on PCPUs 2 and 3 of the physical hardware. And again, in these two wiki pages is where pinning is described, and it's also advised how to use it correctly and for getting the most out of the performances. Another thing that we support in Xen is PCPU pooling, and we call it CPU pools, which means that you can take partition the hardware platform with respect to CPUs and have some of the physical CPUs subject to one scheduler, and the other set, or you can have even more than two sets, handled by either the same scheduler or another scheduler. So basically, this is a more it's similar to pinning, but you totally change the number and the which and what physical CPUs are accessible to each virtual CPUs, but you also can change the scheduling algorithm. So, for example, in this case, we have this pool made up of two physical CPUs. There is a command to show which one they are. I don't have it here. Which are handled by the SCDF scheduler. And this other one with six physical CPU taken care of by the credit one. And of course you can place the virtual machines wherever you want between the two or the, how many pool you have. So these are some of the features that Xen have that are particularly suited for making it a good fit in the embedded and automotive real-time whatever scenario. And this is a list of some others of these characteristics that I think makes it so. So as we already said, it is small. It's a very thin layer of a microkernel hypervisor, which means very small memory footprint, which means very few code actually, which means less bugs, not because we are better than other communities, but because just the laws of probability, because the base onto which to place bug is smaller. And in fact, we are not talking about security here, but if you check out the blog and the very cool operating system based on Xen that at the Invisible Things Labs, which is a security analyst company, actually. They do this thing called CubesOS, which my point is based on Xen, right, because of these characteristics of Xen of being very flexible and very small. Other than that, it being a small project makes it probably easier for it, for example, to be certified if you need that. It's not going to be easy anyway, but at least it's better than other places and than other projects. It's very quick when it comes to booting. So. What Xen does is just set up the environment as far as the CPUs and the memory is concerned, and the interrupt, as I said, and then it just creates what I show you being the DOM 0, and then that's it. So it's going to be very fast to have your DOM zero up and running. And if you need your embedded platform to be up and running quickly, there is a bunch of things that you can do to exploit this this feature, which is not like which is not the same in other solution maybe. Also, of course, there is something that you have to port your operating system on top of Xen, but luckily enough, this is not this is nothing that hard, and there are examples of it in the Xen community, and interacting with us on our mailing list. There are starting to be people doing exactly performing exactly this activity, and especially on ARM, because of how we structured the port of Xen on ARM, it is really really easy to port your OS on top of it. And also the flexibility provided by the security, the all these things provided by the driver domains, which I showed you at the beginning of this presentation. So I had some benchmarks, but the problem with them is that there is really a lot to of combinations to take into account when you want to generate proper numbers to see where are we sitting in this process of having Xen supporting real time and embedded virtualization. So I have a lot of numbers. I still have to data mine them properly and to see whether I am considering enough and the most useful use case and scenarios. So I'm not going to show much details about them, and I'm not going to show much numbers because, as I said, it's a preliminary activity, and I plan to improve it a lot before drawing conclusion out of it. So at least I'm going to be honest and showing you that at least some of the numbers that I have shows that it's probably possible, but we have some work to do. We have to do better in some areas. And of course, we are already down to it, both on the analysis side, so this benchmark and in the process of being automated and integrated in our daily or nightly, if you want, testing and benchmarking infrastructure, so that you can have a constant eye on them and see how things goes. And we are of course starting to investigating the various source of latency, of jitter, of any kind of problems, and figuring out how to solve all these issues. So these are the numbers. So the benchmark are, I don't know if you are familiar with these things, this thing called cyclic test, which is pretty standard tool in the Linux world, at least in the real-time Linux world, at least for figuring out the latency figures that you're getting out of your platform, meaning hardware and operating system. It's basically a task, going to sleep for a definite amount of time, and waking up, and when it wakes up, you measure how longer the sleep lasted with respect to the ideal time it should have slept. And you call it the latency, and that's it. So also, this is not the best. These are benchmark run right on this laptop, so not the best hardware platform either. But this is what you get on bare metal, so just Linux, no Xen hypervisor underneath. And these are the number in the first line. These are the number you get when the system is idle, and these are the number you get when you have the cyclic test program running, as I showed in the previous slide, but with some background noise. And in these other two stanzas, you get the you see the numbers of what happens when you do the same on DOM zero, and what happens when you do the same on a proper DOM U. So, for example, this one down here is not bad, and that's why I say that there is room for a lot of improvement. There is room for getting at least at that level, which it's not that far from what you get on bare metal, a little bit for the average and maximum, but the minimum is good. And also, the problem is not often, the problem is not the minimum, and it's not always and consistently meeting the minimum possible amount of latency. The problem is not having much jitter. So that's what we are concentrating on. And yeah, that's pretty much it. As you have seen, and as I hope you have been able to understand, even if I'm in this condition, I gave you an overview of the architecture, an overview of the scenario we are targeting, a few points of why I think that Xen is a good fit for that, and we discussed a bit about future plans for more benchmarks mostly, and hopefully this. It is served as an illustration of why the Xen project is going to focus a lot in the next few weeks or months, or let's see how long it takes on these workloads and on this area of embedded and real-time virtualization. So a few addresses in the mail, mine, the community, the website of the Xen project and the wiki pages, which they're still kind of stubs right now, but they will soon enough host much more information about all this activity, all this thing that we are doing. And that's really it now.
Questions?
Sure.
sure. We said that earlier in your presentation, you said that on ARM has been a complete rewrite of the code base?
So basically Xen has of course a long history on x86. On x86 we have a lot of features. We support different kind of virtualization, different kind of guests. We have para-virtualization, hardware virtualization, hardware virtualization with para-virtualized driver. We have para-virtualization in hardware virtualized containers. We have all a matrix full of alternatives. We have it's still true that Xen is very small for being such a complex project, but we have a lot of stuff there and a lot of complexity there. On ARM, given that there was a clear specification of what we really wanted to support, so those chips with those very specific extensions for virtualization, the implementation has been from day one targeting that very purpose. And so when I say from scratch, I mean that it did not borrow, and so it didn't carry in all the complexity and all maybe the mistakes that have been done by doing one step after the other and adding one thing after the other on x86, okay. On the x86 world.
And what model do you support on ARM?
What? Sorry.
On one of the slides where you said that you only support one type of guest.
We only support one type of guest because that comes from the fact that we require an ARM v7 or ARM v8 chip, which and the reason why we require is that these are the specification which comes with the virtualization extensions. So basically, if you look at it with x86 glasses, so you try to compare the characteristic of the guest of the guest that we support on ARM to the ones that we have on x86, is something in the middle. Which hopefully will also mean picking up the best of both worlds, because we have the HVM container, we have the HVM support, and we use it on ARM, the extensions, but we also take advantage of a lot of PV path, because we know how to do that, because that's what happened when Xen invented, basically, the para-virtualization. So the good of it we carried on R2.
Right. And how much of the old base is actually a setup or way open? Sorry, in that case, actually,
yeah, sure. We can discuss it offline.
Yeah, offline, yes.
Yeah. So.
Thank you, everyone. Sorry again.